So you get a call from Clint saying, "We want you to be gay for
gay for pay,
Leo for yeah. Leo DiCaprio."
Yeah,
it doesn't seem like that hard a gig.
So I said, "Where the hell do I sign?"
How did when did this come to you? Was this in the middle of Social Network, or was this after Social Network?
No, this was after Social Network. This was a little while after Social Network, long enough after Social Network that I was kind of like, I probably should have a job soon, or this is going to get bad. Mm-hmm. And then I got a call that Clint was doing this new movie, and Fiona Weir, his casting director, wanted me to come in and read for it.
So do people just assume after Social Network that you were like on the way, and they didn't have to call you?
I don't know, but there weren't a lot of calls. If that's what it was, they were wrong. I would have appreciated more calls. No. I'm like, all jokes aside, there was definitely like a time after Social Network where, I remember walking the red carpets on like the Social Network premiere and then being like, well, what are you doing next? And it's like, I can't really say. You can't tell you, and it's like, I just don't really have anything,
There's a kid who was in a movie called Dirty Girl, which I guess sold to Toronto 2 years ago and came out a few months ago with Juno Temple. And he's the lead, really, of the movie with her. And he's still doing the ride at the Terminator ride at Universal Studio Tours.
Yeah.
He's the host.
Yeah.
The Terminator ride. I'm like, really?
Yeah.
People would be like all over you. You should be on a sitcom or something.
I mean, that would always be nice in like an ideal world. But at the same time, I guess you still got to pay the bills,
Yeah. Well, I assume people thought that you would be that like too effete to be coming to you for, something like, Red Riding Hood or something like that.
Yeah.
So I guess now you did a variation on that theme.
I did, Mirror, Mirror.
Mirror, Mirror.
Yeah, which I saw a little bit of recently.
Really?
And I was, pleasantly surprised by it. It was much better than, that kind of movie isn't necessarily my cup of tea.
Right.
It's like that sort of fairy tale adventure. That's not the kind of movie I would choose to go see, but I get the value in the movie, and I also really just wanted to work with Tarsem and Julia,
Yeah.
I mean, that's who was involved when I became involved. Mm-hmm. But I saw part of it recently, and it was really good. It was much better than the trailer. I'll say that. Huh. Yeah.
It's funny how the trailers become so incredibly important at this point. It's like,
yeah,
overwhelms the world.
Yeah. Well, I mean, I guess it's like, it's really your first taste, It's like the first sort of thing you put out there. So you want to make sure you put, start out on your best foot, I guess.
But Tarsem is always so enthusiastic. It's like he seems like he's kind of a mad genius and some sort of giant ego or something. But he's kind of like
No, that's the thing. Like, no ego. He's totally a mad genius. Like, I'll give you that. He's insane. But like no ego to him, which is like one of the most appealing things about him. Like, he's just the nicest dude in the world to everybody, but he is like the ultimate salesman at the same time.
He's always pitching.
Yeah. And I mean, it's that thing, he could sell a ketchup popsicle to a woman in white gloves. He could sell anything,
And Clint would just tell him, take the ketchup popsicle. It's good for you.
Yeah.
You don't have to sell.
You're going to eat this, right? Yes. Do I pay you for this? Do you pay me? How do we do this? Whatever it takes,
So how much did you pay for your role? Were you financing the movie?
I can't really say I'm contractually obliged, but a lot.
Yeah. So you get the phone call from the casting person.
Yeah. And I said, okay, I'd love to read the script. And I read the script and I recognized that it was amazing. And I recognized that it was complex and interesting, but at the same time, I didn't quite understand sort of the nature of their relationship. So I was like, I can't go in and audition for something if I don't really understand it, because I don't want to look like a chump for Clint Eastwood. Like, I only want to go in if I know I can do a good job. And I was like, I don't think I can do a good job on this. Hmm. And my agent was like, are you out of your damn mind? What are you talking about? Get in there and do this. So then, basically had to do a lot of work before the audition. I mean, rightfully so, but spent a lot of time with friends of mine, who were gay, talking to them, like older guys, who might have known what that time was like, and sort of spoke to them and got a sense of it, and then fell madly in love with the character. And it's like, now I name everything Clyde. I'm just in love with Clyde. Like, my Vespa now is named Clyde, the whole thing.
So is there still controversy in your research on this about what the relationship really was?
Not for me. I mean, I had to make definitive sort of decisions and say, this is what happened. This is how, they definitely did this or they didn't do that, But those were my decisions. I know I can't conclusively prove any of them. So it's not like I would go out there and say, well, this happened. But I, for me personally as an actor, I had to make those decisions.
So is Clint there for your first audition or your first meeting?
No, nothing. Clint's not there until the first day of shooting.
Wow.
Yeah, which in a way was nice. I mean, if you had to walk into an audition with Clint Eastwood, it would be, it ups the stakes a little bit,
But you really didn't meet him until the day you started shooting?
I wouldn't have met him until the day we started shooting, except Kevin Spacey, who was one of the producers on Social Network. Uh-huh. We were at the DGA Awards, which was like 2 or 3 weeks right before we were supposed to start shooting. We were at the DGA Awards, and he was like, "Have you met your new director yet?" I was like, "No." He's like, "Well, come on." And I was like, no, I'm good. I'm just going to say I'm good. He's like, "Come on." And he basically dragged me over to Clint's table and was like, "Clint, Army Clint." And Clint was like, "I'm very excited about working together soon." And I was like, great. Anything you want to talk about or anything like that? He's like, "Nope." He's like,
so is that exciting or weird, or how do you feel when you're going through that?
It's terrifying. I mean, it's nerve-wracking. You know, it's like you don't have much sort of direction or guidance going into it because he's not there going, you need to this, you need to do that, you need to, you know,
right.
I want this, I want it to feel like this, I want the storyline to this, I want the character arc to this. You know, he's not there answering those questions. So he really, but which is nice, he puts it in your hands to answer the questions, so you get to do it, which meant I had more work to do personally, but it was like work that I should have been doing anyway, and like good work to do to really understand it all.
So does he ever answer the questions, or you don't ever get to ask them?
We just never had the conversations. Like, I never even posed the questions. Yeah.
So what's the first day like?
The first day, I show up, and it's and they say, okay, you know what, here's your trailer, you know, we'll come get you when we're ready, you know, things move quick, so be ready. And I was like, okay, boom, 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 we're ready. And I was like, oh, geez, okay, let's do this. And I walk out and go into hair and makeup, do the whole thing. I walk onto set, and it's and they go, okay, come on, you gotta sit here, okay, great. And I look, and it's like Leo DiCaprio here, it's like Judi Dench here, it's like Clint Eastwood, it's like, I mean, it's just like, okay, just keep it together. Like, my first day was pretty much just like, don't drool, or like, don't fall over, don't look stupid. And then, you know, you acclimate, I guess, and then you sort of, you know, figure out how to do your process.
They're more intimidating than Jesse Eisenberg, really?
Slightly, yeah. Jesse Eisenberg, that guy's like a little kitten that you just like want to hold, you know. It's like, these guys are like, what am I doing here? Oh my God.
So, how did it go? Did you just start off and he kind of pokes at you a little, or do you even do that?
Yeah, no, we start out the scene and we're sitting there, and Clint's talking to us, and he's like, okay, so you guys, you know, you're here, you're watching the movie, it's a good movie, you like the movie, you're proud of it, it's good things about the Bureau, you know, good, maybe we even look at each other. And I go, oh, something like this, and I kind of look at Leo, smile, he smiles back, and Clint goes, yeah, just like that, okay. And then, like, that was it, cut, print, moving on.
Wow.
Yeah.
So one take, or?
One take. Well, I mean, I didn't even know it was a take. I thought we were just talking. I mean, like, that was the take, you know?
God. So was it like that through most of the movie? Was it very wham, bam, thank you, ma'am?
He's consistent. Like, he doesn't change. So as soon as you realize his process, you're like, oh, okay, well, we're just going to jump right into this, and we're going to go for it. You know, we're not going to put down marks. We're not going to make decisions. We're going to keep it raw. We're going to keep it fresh, and we're just going to go. So once you figure that out, and you sort of, you know, figure out the tone and sort of how he works, then it's like you just show up and you're like, all right, dude, I've been warming up in my trailer, I'm ready, let's do this. What do you got, you know? And so you sort of have to show up with that attitude, because you can't find it or discover it while shooting, because you don't have that many takes.
So do you work through it with Leo?
No.
Mm-mm. So you guys were having a relationship but not discussing the relationship as you went along,
which kind of worked perfectly. Yeah. You know,
interesting.
Yeah. I mean, we had one rehearsal where Leo, Lance, and I got together at Leo's house and read through the whole script just in one go, you know, but like this. No, Clyde, don't do this. How can you treat me like this? You know, you didn't do that. Like, like, with about that much emotion. So, you know, we just showed up and kept it fresh every day on set.
So did it feel like it has felt on other movies? Did it feel like it was clicking, or did you know where you were, or?
That's a good question. It definitely didn't feel like other movies. But then again, I mean, I don't really have that much experience to draw from. You felt the flow. Like, there was more of a flow with the crew and with the project than anything else I've ever been involved in. Like, from the moment the day starts, it's like, just feels effortless. It feels easy. Like, it's like, he's got everything, like, just like planned out. Like, put the camera there, do that, boom, 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 two takes there, done. And it's gonna sound weird, but like, it almost is like what shooting television could be if it was done perfectly. Mm-hmm. You know, where it's like, I know we gotta get this, so let's put the camera there and get that, then we gotta get this and that, but it doesn't feel like a cheap experience,
right?
Like TV. It still feels epic, like you're working with Clint Eastwood, you know, but it felt effortless and easy through the course of it.
Which, like, you're doing TV with Frankenheimer or Lumet, not like.
Exactly, exactly,
Joe
exactly.
Schmuck.
Yeah. So, I mean, I felt that flow, and I just sort of had to trust that. Like, I never went home feeling like I put in enough. Like, I think, you know, especially with Social Network being my first real sort of experience, you know, and working that hard, it sort of set the tone for me so that, you know, everything I've done since then, it's like I always feel like I'm not working hard enough, you know? So I always thought, you know, I never left it the day going, ah, got it, that was fantastic. I was always like, I could have done this on another take, and I always, oh, I had that other idea that I wanted to try, and man, he said that, and I should have reacted like this. You know, it's like you kind of go home wishing you got more takes, but you ultimately have to trust Clint, I guess.
So did you, did the production build two things? Did you get to the wrestling scene late in the production,
yeah,
or did you
jump
right into wrestling? Or?
Yeah, Clint was really good about that, and Rob as well with the schedule. Rob Lorenz, who, you know, his producing partner, and also was his first AD for a long time. But, you know, the wrestling scenes came towards the end of us doing the young stuff, and then the old stuff we all did in one chunk. So it's like they kept it as chronological as possible, you know, allowing for locations and stuff like that.
And he pretty much shoots and puts on the screen what was on the script.
Yeah,
yeah. There's not a whole lot of stuff disappearing.
There was a couple scenes that got cut out here and there, you know, but nothing like a couple scenes of Clyde that I felt sort of explained the younger Clyde a little bit better. There was a couple of those scenes, but with them out of the movie, like watching it, I'm not thinking, oh, I can't believe they took that out. I went, oh yeah, okay, yeah, it flows better, sure, good, good call, you know.
So it all made sense.
Yeah, it all made sense.
And the script is pretty much sacrosanct on the set?
I wouldn't say sacrosanct. I would say that you certainly have creative license. Like if you go up to him and you say, you know, Clint, in my research I found that, you know, they sort of, he might have said it like this instead of like that. And he'd go, okay. And he's like, okay, great. Nice talking to you. And then you go and you say it how you want. And he goes, good job, that was great.
Yeah.
You know, that kind of thing. Lance was around for a while too. So he was always there to, you know, talk things over with and stuff like that. But, you know, I mean, Clint shoots what he gets, but at the same time, like, he is Clint Eastwood. I don't think any script ends up on his desk that's not ready to be shot, you know?
Well, it's a funny thing, because, like, Peter Morgan last year had done, you know, Hereafter.
Yeah.
And that was a script he had put away at some point.
Yeah.
And came back out, and he was ready to rewrite, and then Clint was like, no, I'm making it as it is.
Yeah.
And he was kind of in shock of how, you know, Clint just takes the script.
Yeah.
That once he likes the script, that's it. He's into it. He's going.
Yeah. I think once Clint sends his mind to something, it's like, good luck getting in the way, you know?
Yeah. So what was the biggest challenge of doing this for you?
I don't know, man. It had like its own like unique challenges. Like definitely the old age makeup was difficult. Like that's, you know, I mean, you're, for all intents and purposes, you're super gluing a mask to your face that they still expect you to emote through. You know, I mean, that's not easy, you know, it's certainly nothing I've ever had to do before. And it's also, you know, it's probably not something anyone will have to do for a long time into the future anyway. It's becoming a very obsolete way to do things. You know, I mean, any other director would have done this with CGI and it probably would have looked better. It would have been cheaper and it would have been faster. But you know what, like Clint's very nostalgic. And like you say, once he sets his mind to doing something, that's the way we're going to do it. And he liked the prosthetic process. And you know what, I gotta say, like, as a young actor who won't get to do that it probably ever again, like, it was a really fun process. But you know, you walk into your trailer after you've spent, you know, 8 hours sitting perfectly still, and then you start your work day. But you know, you walk into your trailer and you sort of sit in the mirror and you go, okay, I gotta figure this out. What does it look like if I smile? And you're like, oh, that's not right. So you're like, okay, I have to pull my cheeks up and I have to squint my eyes and I have to curl my lip up. It's like you sort of have to find new ways to work with your face, which is interesting. But it also, you know, was helpful as a guy who went through a stroke and had to learn that again anyway, you know?
And half your days are makeup, you think? Or
Leo's makeup always seemed to go quicker than mine, which I was always jealous about. But his was, I think, like 5.5-6 hours. Mine was always around like 7.5, like maybe 8 if I was fidgety those days, you know? But I mean, you have to sit in a makeup chair, and like I have a funny picture where the makeup artist finally like would tie down my arms because I would always be like, "Hey, what's this over there? Like, let me just, I gotta, it's, hey, let me just get my phone out." They were always just like, "Yeah," and I was like, "Oh." So there's like a funny picture where they finished my makeup, but they didn't untie me as a joke. So I'm in the full old age makeup, trying to pick out of my restraints with my teeth. But yeah, like that was just how you start your day. So you show up at 9, you're done doing the makeup probably around 4:30 in the afternoon, something like that, and then you start your day and you shoot until, you know, 11 o'clock, midnight, and then it takes another 2 or 3 hours to get the makeup off, and then you know you got to show up the next day again, you know. So those were the longest days, and they were at the end of the production when everybody was already tired anyway. But it just like those days specifically, you know, the you didn't arrest Karpis, you know, you didn't do that. The our sort of show off really at the end where he finally kisses me, like that was the last scene we shot. So I just remember like standing on set, going through that whole experience, which was lightning quick. I mean, it was a 35-day shoot, and just sitting around with all these people who it's like. You just create such a quick relationship with, and you feel all this emotion for, and then you're just doing this great scene with Clint and everybody, and then he says stop for the last time, and you're just like, wow, I'm done, and it's like, all right, time to go get this makeup off, you know. So it was
You have a little bit of energy, I've noticed over these years.
Yeah, a little bit.
But it seems like it would be an incredible energy drain to sit there.
I do have energy, but I think I'm like a cold-blooded like reptile, some kind like. I have bursts of energy, and then it's like I'm like this for like a week, you know?
So do you have to be like that in the chair intentionally? Do you have to try to energy down so you have
by the end of the,
something
by
on
the
set?
By the end of doing the you know, the prosthetic process, like I was comfortable enough that I could like fall asleep during it, which was like, those were the days where it's like, I'd wake up looking like an old man and be like, ha, let's go, you know? And everyone was like, shut up, everyone else is tired. I know you're awake because you've been sleeping for 8 hours in the middle of the day, you know?
So how hard was that being an old man besides the makeup itself, that, you know, just figuring out how to do that, be that person?
It was intensive. Like there was I made sure to really give it its like, you know, due diligence. I read a lot of information about people who suffered strokes. And there's one great book that this lady called Jill Bolte Taylor wrote, and it's called A Stroke of Insight. And it's this lady who was like a neuroanatomist who had a stroke, but because she was a neuroanatomist, I think she was in the gym or something like that, and she reached for something and like her hand just fell. And she immediately knew, oh my God, I'm having a stroke. Whereas anybody else would have been like, oh, dead arm or whatever.
Right.
She was like, I have to call 911. So it took her something like 2 or 3 hours to get to the phone and dial 911 while going through the stroke. But they were able to get to her quickly enough so that she could make a full recovery. So now she has completely sort of diagrammed what it's like to have a stroke. I mean, of course, hers was in a, you know, specific part of her brain, so it was very different. But that was really helpful, sort of, you know, just watching how strokes affect your muscular system and your nervous system and all that, and the shakes and sort of the palsy kind of thing and all that. Like, it was really interesting sort of looking into all that. And it was informative, sort of wearing all the prosthetic makeup and the old clothes and being uncomfortable and all that. So it informed how you walked and all that. It was great.
So did you get a lot of whispering from Clint and that part of it? Does he say, you know,
no, dude, he
a little bit more, a little bit less, a little
no, I don't ever really remember him doing anything like that, but I really don't think he would know. Like, he is the youngest he's the youngest octogenarian the world may have ever seen. Like, in between camera setups, he'll literally walk into a room and go, all right, you put the camera there, you guys, you know, stand wherever you want, literally stand wherever you want, and you know, set up the lights, I'll be right back. And then he'll walk off the stage and go to the gym that he has built wherever we're filming and just like pump weights in between camera setups. And he'll come back to like shoot the thing and he'll have like veins bulging out of his biceps. And I'm like, I'm 24 years old at the time. I don't have veins in my biceps. Like, he's showing me up in every way. You know, I mean, he I don't think he knows anything about being an old man.
So was there an easy part of doing this? Was there a part that was falling off a horse?
Yeah, the quick days were the easiest thing about it. You know, I mean, it's the only project I've ever done where you drive home at the end of the day after a full day of shooting and the sun's out, you know, and you get home while the sun's setting and you're like, this is really nice, you know?
So it sounds like it was smooth.
It was smooth. Like, that's a great word for it. It was like effortless. It was just smooth.
So it
was like, as Clint would tell you, it's like good jazz, man. He just had everything flowing, you know, it's like, there was a good vibe going.
So when you see the picture, how surprising is it, or is it surprising? Do you kind of know what's coming?
I don't know. It's so hard, man. You know, it's like when you see the movie, as a performer in the movie, you can't suspend your disbelief. Like, you can't go along on the journey.
It's right.
Like, it's always that thing where you hear your voice on your answering machine, and you're like, ugh. You know, it's like that. But it's like, it's really unfortunate because I love movies so much, but being in one sucks you out of it. You know, uh-huh. It's like you can't go on the journey. Like, you can't really enjoy it. You're like, oh, I remember when we shot that, it was this time, or oh, it was raining, but it doesn't even look like it there. Oh, uh-huh. You know, oh, Steve was there on that one, and we did this and that, and that. You know, it's like, I just see like sort of the culmination of the whole technical process, which is great. You know, it's like, but I don't see the full movie, you know?
And you're not watching yourself so much, you're still watching other things?
No, I'm watching myself too much, which is why you can't get into anything, because you're like, why the hell am I standing like that? Ugh, that's how I'm gonna say that line? Really? I put the inflection on that word? Like, you know, all those things.
Huh. So how many times have you seen this movie? Twice?
Just twice. I saw once when they did like a screening before it was like finalized.
Right.
And then the premiere.
So you're like, I can't take it anymore, I'm never gonna watch this again, or?
Yeah.
How many times did you watch Social Network?
Twice.
That was same problem, same enough of that?
Yeah, same thing. I mean, that one is so, that movie, you know, I mean, and Fincher are both so technically flawless that it's easy to watch that movie and just sort of go, wow, look at how he did that with the angle on that, and the tone and the hue of this color and that, you can do that, I think, more on Social Network than you can any other project I've done, you know?
Well, there's a lot of stuff going on, I'm sure, in Mirror.
Yeah.
Distract you.
I mean, it's someone was like, well, what's it like? And I was like, well, it would be like if you took Snow White and made her eat like a pound of mushrooms. It's kind of like that.
It's magic.
Yeah.
And now you're going to start working with another hack, Gore Verbinski.
Yeah, gosh, really. You'd think I'd have some taste by this point. Yeah.
So how exciting is it to be in the midst of all of this? I mean, you kind of gone from being an unknown quantity completely almost to now being in, you know, movie after movie that's very high profile.
Yeah. I mean, I recommend it. It's definitely worse than not having a job, which is where I was for a long time. So it's great. You know, it does come with its whole own set of, issues that, you know, as someone who's only been hunting for jobs, I don't quite have all the tools to deal with, like sort of picking and choosing and turning down jobs. That still is something to me that's like, really, are you sure we're going to have to do that? Like, okay, you know, like that's still like nerve-wracking, you know?
Right.
It's fantastic. Like, I couldn't be more appreciative of the way things are going. You know, it's like I've really had a chance to piggyback on people who are much more talented than I am. So it's it's been nice. You know, it's like I'm really happy with the way things are going. And after Lone Ranger, I'm going to take like a little break and just do like a couple really small independent movies, which I'm excited about, you know?
So do people give you advice? Do the actors who've been around? I mean, you've worked with all these actors and directors who have been around forever.
Right.
Done a lot. You know, you're going from, Fincherland to Eastwoodland to Tarsem World to Johnnyland.
Yeah. Yeah.
Do they go, okay, this is how you should do it, young man. This is.
No, like I haven't had too many like sort of mentoree sessions. Have heard a plethora of awesome stories. Like that's like that's one of the highlights. It's just like, you did what? Where? With who? You know, just like, oh my God. You know, all those stories.
So it's fun to be in the community.
Well, I mean, it's the same thing that, like, you know, if I was a glassblower, it would be really an awesome opportunity and experience to get a job working with, you know, craftsmen who've been doing it for 30 years up to 60 years, whatever it is, you know, and just hearing their stories about the time they blew this and the time they did that or made this. And you're just like, oh, I'm totally into this because I'm a nerd about this thing too, you know?
And there was a blow joke in there too.
There was, yeah, several.
That was one of Julia's stories. Yeah. Oh, no, yeah. Probably not. Yeah. And is it beginning to feel like a career arc? I mean, obviously you're kind of had some great opportunities, but are you beginning to think about what it means 2 years from now, 5 years from now for you?
In terms of like decisions that I make?
Yeah, decisions you make and where you're going and what you want and that kind of thing.
Oh, yeah. I don't. No, I haven't like really found myself thinking like that in terms of, you know, setting myself up for things. I mean, I definitely have people and like a team whose job it is to do that. So, you know, they do a great job of that. So I can only make decisions based on, you know, what artistically draws me, I guess.
Right.
Is it raining?
Maybe, eventually.
Maybe it's probably just
you're just being dripped on by the fountain.
Yeah.
That's how you know you're
there. Might
be
another joke
the
in there, too.
Yeah.
No, I'm not.
Paul Sorvino's coming out.
The what's that?
Paul Sorvino's coming out.
Yeah.
Italian fountain joke.
Yeah.
So, And is it what you thought it would be?
No. I mean, it's kind of like marriage. Like, I recently got married, and it's like, I had a fantastic relationship beforehand. Like, we couldn't have loved each other more. We were perfectly engaged and happy and everything. And then we got married, and it just, it didn't feel that different. It just felt like a continuation of what we'd already been doing and what we were already so happy with. So it's like, it's the same thing with this. It's like, it doesn't feel like markedly different. It just feels like I'm getting more opportunities to do what I love and to do, you know, what sort of drives me. But they're just like bigger and bigger opportunities. That being said, there's definitely, I mean, there definitely becomes more that's like expected of you.
Right.
You know, it's, I mean, a year and a half ago, we would have never been sitting here doing this interview or anything like that. You know, I mean, that wouldn't have been something that I would have had to do, you know? And this is also not something that I'm, you know, good at or necessarily or, you know, trained at or really focused on. This is just something that you have to do as part of the job, you know, which is fine. I mean, you know, there's always prerequisites with or requisites with jobs. But, you know, I mean, it's definitely different. It's definitely awesome. You know, I mean, it's I think it's always good to be employed.
Is the work what you thought it would be?
Yeah, the work is the, this is the thing. The work just gets deeper and deeper and deeper and deeper and deeper as you, Archie, come here. Come here. The work gets like deeper and deeper and deeper as you work with people who are more and more and more talented, because it's like, it just facilitates that atmosphere where you can take it farther and farther and farther and farther, you know?
Is Archie named after Cary Grant?
Yeah, he is. He is Archie Winston Leach Hammer.
Wow, that's like a lot of name.
Yeah.
For a little dog.
It's like a wasp overload on the name. My wife, Archie Leach, was like my requisite. She was like, well, then he'll be Archibald Winston Leach Hammer, and I was like, okay, I'm glad he's not going to middle school because he would get so picked on.
And are you starting? Have you started writing?
What's that?
Have you started writing?
No, I've started like brainstorming, and I'm like an idea person. I love coming up with ideas and sort of brainstorming with writers, but like I can't sit down.
No,
and
not
just
writing. Writing. R-I-D.
Oh, writing. Oh. Okay. No, but we leave in like 2 weeks or like what's the date? We leave in like a week and a half to go to New Mexico to start doing all the training with the horses and the guns and all that. So.
And does that just seem like a dream come true for any boy to go and play cowboys and Indians?
Totally. It's like, yeah, I mean, I get to be a cowboy. I get to be the Lone Ranger. I get to have horses and guns and like the whole thing. Yeah, it's going to be great.
And Archie will be with you, I assume.
Yeah. Archie, come on. Come here.
See, I think that's how Eastwood does it.
Hey!
Army, hey, come here.
Excuse me, I have to go beat the shit out of my dog. No, sorry.
And the perfect place to stop.
Yeah.